Hi everyone, welcome back! For loops are like our old friends that we can always count on, right? But sometimes we want new adventures. So today we will dive into the exciting world of alternatives to for loops in JavaScript. I'm going to show you the for loop version first and how you can do exactly that with a method. So let's start with alternative number one. That's the for each method. If you ever need to iterate over the elements of an array, of course, writing a for loop is a valid alternative. Here we have an example. We have the array definition, we have the for loop, and you can always iterate over this, the loop variable I, and go from 0 to the length of the array. But there is another alternative that is much more readable if you only need to work with the elements themselves. Instead of this, we could write something like this, my array, and then call this method. Let me close the terminal for now so we can focus on the code. The method is for each. The method takes as an argument an arrow function. The arrow function has to take the element itself as an argument, and then with the small arrow symbol, we are going to define what to do with that element. What do we want to do with the element to get the exact same output that we had over here? We were just like printing the elements of the array. We're going to use exactly the same, console.log. And we can use the element variable here directly because the for each method will pass each element here as an argument, so we can use it in the body of the arrow function. If we run the code, now we can open the terminal, you can see that node for each.javascript, you can see that we have the same output twice, 1, 2, 3, 4 for the first for loop, and 1, 2, 3, 4, so they are exactly the same, but you can see that this is much more readable. Our second alternative is the find method. If you've ever wanted to find an element in our array that meets specific criteria, the find method is exactly what you need. Here we have the array definition, and we're declaring a variable element found, because we're going to try to do this with a for loop. Here we have the for loop, we're iterating over all the elements in the array, and then we have a conditional that is checking the criteria that we're looking for. Here we are looking for an element that is greater than 6. When that element is found, it's assigned to the variable and then the loop breaks. The loop just stops. So basically, we're trying to find an element in this sequence, in this collection. How can we do that more concisely with a method? Let me show you. We have the find method. Let's close the terminal now and focus on the code and do exactly the same thing that we have over here in just one line. Yes, I promise you it's just one line of code compared to this entire for loop. First of all, we're going to get the element found. The method is going to return the element that matches that criteria. So we're going to assign the result to a variable, element found. And then we're going to call the method on that array, find. This method also takes an arrow function. So we're going to pass an arrow function that takes the actual element as an argument and returns true if that element matches the criteria that we are looking for, and false if the element doesn't match that criteria. So we're writing what we had here in the condition. We're basically just saying exactly the same thing in the arrow function over here. The first element that matches the criteria is the one that will be returned and assigned to this variable. Here we do not need to declare this variable again because we already declared it here above. Here at the top, okay? But if we are declaring it for the first time, we do need the let keyword. Great, so let's print element found over here before the second alternative, and let's see if the outputs match. This will be the element found by the loop, and this will be the element found by the find method. Let's see, if they are the same, then the process is exactly the same. 7 and 7, yes, they match, so they are equivalent. Find is super helpful when you need to find an element in an array that matches a criteria. It also works for different collections. So now let's go to our third alternative, the filter method. We can also extend the idea even further to find all the elements that match a certain criteria, because previously with find, we only got the first element, which was number 7. But what if we want to find all the elements that match a specific criteria? Well, instead of using find, in that case, we can use filter. So let's see how we can do that. First, let's run the code and see the output of this for loop. We run node filter.js. This is how I named my file, and I can see it right here that I am getting a list with two elements, 7 and 8, because these are the two elements that match that criteria. They match the criteria of being greater than 6. So let's use filter. Let's call filter now to replace these lines of code. You can do that much more concisely. With this method, you will also get all the elements found. So you will need to assign the result to a variable if you want to use them later on. Then you need to write the name of your variable, in this case it's my array, and then call the filter method. The filter method also takes an arrow function, and this arrow function takes every element in the array and checks if the element matches a specific criteria, the same thing that we had previously with find. We are doing exactly the same thing with this for loop and with this single line of code, so you can see how powerful this can be for writing concise and clear code. We are going to print this variable, the elements found variable, twice, to see if the numbers match, to see if the results match, with the for loop and with the method. And indeed, they do match. Amazing, right? Find and filter are super powerful. After that, we find the slice method. The slice method is very helpful when we need to find a slice of a sequence. Of course, we could do something like that with a for loop, and I'm showing you an alternative here, an implementation that can be much more concise. Here we are defining two variables, start and end, and we are just pushing the elements of the array from start to end to a new array. We're basically creating two arrays to store that data, from a specific index to a specific index. And let's check the output here if we run the code. Node slice.js. Here we have 5, 6, and 7. So we are getting the numbers here, these elements in the middle of the array. So we want to get exactly the same list just by calling the slice method. Again, we are going to get a new array. So we're going to assign this to the new array variable. You can assign any name that you think would be descriptive in your code. Then you use the array variable that you're working with, you call the slice method, and then you pass the parameters. In this case, we're going to pass the parameters 1 and 4. We're going to start from index 1 to 3, and then before index 4, we're going to stop. Notice that in this loop, we're not including the value of the end variable. So we're going to stop at index 4 to have the equivalent result. Here we are going to run the code again, and we can see that they actually match exactly. That is slice. We just have two more methods, so stay with me until the end to find how they work. Let's go to map. The map method is very, very helpful when you want to transform the values of an array. When you need to generate new values based on existing values of an array or a sequence in JavaScript. For example, when you need to multiply them by a specific value or transform them in some way or operate with them in some way, and each element will generate a new element that you need to store. Here we are using this variable myArray with these numbers, and then we are defining a new array. We're iterating over all the elements of that array, and then we are pushing the new elements to a new array. These new elements are the original elements multiplied by 3. That's the content of the new array. So we're going to take 4, multiply it by 3, and then we're going to push it to the new array. And we can see this. The new array that we are generating has these elements, these values, multiplied by 3. With the map method, we also need to assign the value, the return value, to a variable. So we're going to assign it to new array. We take the original array and we call the map method. And this method also takes an arrow function. This arrow function takes each element as an argument, and then it returns the new value that you want to generate. So let's say that you want to multiply every single element by 3. That is what you're going to write over here. It's usually an expression that you are going to return, a value. Each one of these values will be added or pushed one by one to the new array, and then the new array will be assigned to this variable. Let's print both of them so we can see the output over here, and we see that they match exactly, so they are equivalent. We're doing exactly the same thing in just one line. And finally, we are going to the reduce method, the last method that we're going to see in this video, this sixth option. The reduce method is helpful when you try to perform an operation with the values of the array, and this operation combines them in a way that results in one value. So if you want to add them or multiply them or transform them in some way, but the result will be just one value, then the reduce method is helpful in that particular situation. Of course, we can do that with a for loop, like in this case. Let's say that we want to add or find the sum of all of these numbers in the array, of all of these elements. And with this for loop, we're iterating over the entire array, and then we are adding each one of them with this operator and assigning the resulting sum to this variable. The result should be 30. We're adding all of these numbers, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8, which is 30. How can we do exactly the same thing with reduce? First of all, we need to assign the result to a variable if we want to use it later on. Then we write the name of the array, we call the reduce method like this, and then we will have an arrow function that is a bit more elaborate, a bit more complicated, because it will have two arguments. It will have the arguments partial sum, in this case since we're adding all the elements, and it will have the element that it's currently evaluating. The first argument is an accumulator. It's going to accumulate the value that you are going to write over here in this expression that we still need to write, and it's going to take the current element that we are processing, and you can write the expression over here to work with that accumulated value and the new element. So if we're adding these elements, these numbers, to get their sum, we're, for example, we can be here, we can add 4 and 5 to get the value 9. That would be the partial sum that we have so far. And the new element would be number 6. So if we want to add 6 to 9, we're going to get the full sum, or the partial sum. And that partial sum will be used in the next step, when we get the value 7. In the next iteration, the partial sum will be 4 plus 5 plus 6, which is 15. Then the element will be 7. And we will continue adding that partially until we accumulate all the values, until we have the final accumulated value. What do we want to do with this partial sum and the element? We want to add them. We get the partial sum that we have so far, and we get the new element that we are processing. What do we want to do? We want to add it. And finally, we also start the accumulator at the value 0. This is the initial value of the accumulator. Something important to highlight here is that this 0 is separated from the arrow function by a comma. It's actually an argument that you pass to the reduce method. It's not part of the arrow function. It's a different argument that you pass to the reduce function to tell it the initial value of this accumulator. You can start the accumulator from a different value, but in this case, since we're calculating a sum, we're going to start it from 0. Great, so let's run the code, node reduce.js, and we get the value 30. Exactly what we expected. We're adding all the values in the array, and the final value that we are getting is 30. So that is great, because our code is working. These were 6 alternatives to for loops in JavaScript. I encourage you to practice them and find more information about them in the documentation. Please let me know in the comments if you would like me to dive deeper into any one of these methods, and I will be glad to record a video for the channel. I will see you in the next video. Thank you for watching.